You see it through till the end. You see it through till the end. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. In the silence, in the waiting, still we can know you are good. All your plans are for your glory. Yes, we can know you are good. Yes, we can know are good. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing
to Twickenham. If you are a guest this morning, we are really glad that you've come out to be with us. Thanks for being here. There's a card on the seat right in front of you. You can pull one of those out, indicate your presence here this morning. If there's an update to your address that we don't have, might be good to give us that. And if you'd like, if you're a guest and you'd like to fill that out, we will be glad to send you some information about our church. We promise we won't visit you without an invitation, that we won't sell your information to any marketers or anything like that. You can also indicate any prayer requests on there, and we will be praying about those as early as tomorrow. So you can put that in the collection plate when it passes a little bit later in our service. Also, if you are looking for a church home, we are always looking for new family members. Would love to sit down and visit with you about that. So just thanks for being here today. I wanted to start with some family news this morning, just to kind of, we're going to end just with song and prayer toward the end of our service, about an hour from now. So I wanted to go ahead and tell you a couple of things that are important. Obviously, you can look at the bulletin, but Wanda Jordan, a member here at Twickenham, passed away this past week. And her funeral will be held here at our building on Tuesday. There will be a visitation, two visitations, in fact. The first will be Monday evening from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. downstairs in the fellowship hall. So Monday from 5 to 7, and then Tuesday from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock here in the main auditorium, and then the funeral itself will be held here at 11 o'clock. So keep that family in your prayers as we move ahead. The other important thing that I wanted to mention to you is that our, and this is in the bulletin as well, we are accumulating blessings to go into the blessing bags that we're going to give to the homeless in the Huntsville area next Saturday. You have responded wonderfully to that. You'll see the boxes in the lobbies, and they are filling up. Next Saturday morning from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., we're going to meet here at the building and put those blessing bags together, and then we're going to take them out, and working with the Downtown Rescue Mission, we're going to pass those out to some homeless folks. This is a great opportunity for you to invite somebody that doesn't have a church home and may not even be a Christian at all, may not even be a believer. It's a great opportunity for you to invite them to do something that they would find meaningful. Helping other folks is sort of a cultural value these days. And if you give somebody an opportunity to do that, and they're able to do that around a bunch of Christians, then that gives us a chance to share the Lord with them. So just think about being involved in it just from an evangelistic point of view, just inviting somebody to come and work with you to help take care of folks that don't have anybody to take care of them. Hey, Lincoln, can you guys come on up here? I want to mention a scripture to you here that I love this passage. I guess it's my favorite passage, kind of changes from week to week, but I always come back to this one in Ephesians. I'm just going to read the verse to you, and then I'll tell you why it's my favorite. It is, "By grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." We don't do good things like attending somebody's visitation to bless a family, or coming to church, or making blessing bags for the homeless. We don't do those things so that we can get saved. We do those things because we have been. Our foundation is not on our good deeds. Our foundation is on what God did for us in Jesus Christ. And because of that, no matter what you're going through today, you can lift your hand in praise to Him. Let's stand, let's sing, and glorify God about the foundation that we have in Jesus Christ.
Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. I have a living hope. Of this I'm sure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Oh, Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Your word is faithful. Of this I'm sure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I know I can stand secure. Jesus, you're my firm foundation. I put my hope in your holy word. I put my hope in your holy word. Words up. sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words.
Took you from the ends of the earth, from its farthest corners, I called you. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and have not rejected you. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. For I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. horizons we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Be their shepherd and carry them forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King.
His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
With a mighty hand and outstretched arm,
his love endures forever.
And for the life that's been reborn,
his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise.
Come on, church, forever.
Forever, God. His love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever.
Say that anymore because Lincoln always said it, and he didn't say it today. So if you want to stand through the whole sermon, you can't. Sit down. Please. Hey, I got a tweet this week from a, and you're going to, somebody's going to make fun of me about this. I got a tweet this week from a German theologian named Jürgen Moltmann. I follow German theologians, okay? They say some cool stuff. Moltmann was born in Hamburg, Germany, 1926, and he was raised in a thoroughly secular home. There was just no belief in God whatsoever in the home in which he grew up. And when World War II, actually before World War II started, he was drafted into the German army. And after a few weeks of training, he was sent to the front lines. And he was not comfortable with what was going on in his country. And so the first British soldier that he encountered, he surrendered to. He just gave himself up to get out of it. And he was sent to a prison camp, and he was transferred from one prison camp to another. And in later in the war, some of the prison camps would put up pictures of what was going on at Buchenwald and Auschwitz. And he would later write that he was gnawed by those photographs. They gnawed at him internally. And it really troubled him. He was deeply ashamed of what his country was doing. An American chaplain gave Moltmann one of those little New Testament in Psalms. I don't know if you've ever seen one of those, but it's the Matthew to Revelation and then the Psalms. And the chaplain gave it to him, and he read it. And years later, he would write, "I didn't find Christ. Christ found me." And so when the war was over, he went back to Germany and helped do some rebuilding. But he entered seminary, and he became one of the leading theologians of the 20th century. Now, it's a fascinating story, and you got to really respect a guy who's born on the wrong side of the war, where he's drafted to support this tyrant and this evil philosophy, Nazism, and gets out of it as soon as he can. You got to respect a guy like that. And spends his life trying to understand the kingdom of God and communicate that to people. And at the age of 91, tweets something this profound. I really love this quote. "What anxiety and hope actually have in common is a sense of what is possible." In anxiety, we anticipate possible danger. In hope, we anticipate possible deliverance. Isn't that cool? You'll want to remember that, not just for this week, but for later in this message. Anxiety anticipates danger. Hope anticipates deliverance. This morning, we're going to continue to explore this idea of journeys, of going when and where God says to go. And of course, we're not talking about an actual physical trip. Journey is a metaphor for a life of faith. It implies patience. And that's hard, because we live in a culture and we are a people who want what we want, and we want it right now. Journey is about taking the long view. The answer to the question, are we there yet? Whether we're talking about a church or a marriage or your parenting or your personal spiritual journey, are we there yet? The answer is always no. We are still on the way. The journey way of life questions everything about how we live and how we think. It questions how we use our time. It questions what we do with our money. It questions who we invite into our relationships. And as we'll see this morning, it questions how we respond when the journey takes us to places we did not expect to go. Do we respond in hope, or do we respond in anxiety? Our guide has been a man named Abram, or better known as Abraham. And his story is in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. And this morning, if you want to go ahead and turn over there, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. In our last episode with Abraham, God told him to leave his country, to leave his people, to leave his father's house, and go where God would tell him to go. Go where God would show him. In other words, Abraham, I want you to take a journey, and I'm not going to tell you where you're going. There's nowhere to forward your mail to. Just go. Pack up and leave. But God did give him a really extravagant promise. He said, I will make you into a great nation, and I will make your name great, and I will bless you, and I will make you a blessing. And the really crazy thing here is that Abraham believed God. And so he took the journey. He packed up and left. And so our intrepid man of faith has launched out on this journey. When God said go, he went. He's full of hope, and he's full of trust, and he's full of faith until he gets there. And then things get messy. Things get really messy. We're going to hear the story, and then we'll rummage around in it a bit to see what we can discover. I'm reading from Genesis chapter 12, beginning in verse 10. Now, there was a famine in the land. Okay, God tells you go, I'm going to send you to this promised land, and you get there, and the first thing you discover is that there is a famine in the land. So what does he do? Abram went down to Egypt to live for a while because the famine was severe. And as he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife, Sarai, I know what a beautiful woman you are. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife? And then they'll kill me, but we'll let you live. Say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you. When Abram came to Egypt, the Egyptians saw that Sarai was a very beautiful woman. And when Pharaoh's officials saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh, and she was taken into his palace. He treated Abram well for her sake. And Abram acquired sheep and cattle and male and female donkeys and male and female servants and camels. But the Lord inflicted serious diseases on Pharaoh and his household because of Abram's wife, Sarai. So Pharaoh summoned Abram. What have you done to me? He said, why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she's my sister so that I took her to be my wife? Now here is your wife. Take her and go. And Pharaoh gave orders about Abram to his men, and they sent him his way with his wife and everything he had. Well, clearly, Abraham has taken a bit of a detour on the journey. And I don't know about you, but my first temptation when I read this story or remember this story is to get all judgy about how Abraham responds. And the truth is, he does do some pretty despicable things. First, he manipulates his wife with a compliment. I know what a beautiful woman you are. Everybody says so. Which is why wives have evolved to respond to those kinds of statements with, what do you want? Second, he asks her to lie to save his own hide. I want you to tell them you're my sister. They'll be nice to me then. Third, he lies to the Egyptians. And fourth, he profits from his deception. Now, if you grew up in the rural South, and maybe they do this in the rural North too, I don't know. But if you grew up in the rural South, you know we have a word for that kind of behavior. Sorry. That's what I would have heard when I was growing up. My parents, my grandparents, it would say things about people like Abraham. They'd say, he's sorry. And in this episode, he really was. But you know, it's a little too convenient to dismiss Abraham's decisions as self-centered and oafish, because if we judge him too quickly, we will fail to see that we are more like him than we would like to admit. So let's ease off Abram here for just a minute. Let's ask this, which is always a good question to ask when you see people doing things that you would consider sorry. Why does Abraham make these moves? Why does he take this detour? I mean, people do things for reasons, right? Why is he doing this? Well, if you take this episode and you put it on the autopsy table and you really try to get into it and figure out the anatomy of this detour, what you discover is that he had some reasons. Verse 10 mentions that famine. mentions the famine twice. The second time he mentions it, it says it was a severe famine. In an agrarian culture where everything is based on what's happening to the land, that's not just a big deal. That's the only deal there is. That's huge. It's the equivalent of trying to feed your family and pay your bills by working a tech job in a town that has no technology. Okay, right now, imagine going to work or going to the work that you used to go to with no internet, no computers, nothing but, well, some of you can remember nothing but a slide rule, okay? But it would be very difficult to do that kind of work without the tools required for doing that kind of work. In other words, it would be impossible to feed your family and pay your bills. So the first thing we have to acknowledge is that Abraham is in a precarious situation. And it's not just that there's a famine. They are foreigners in a strange country. That makes them vulnerable. When he left his home in Haran, Abraham was a man of promise. He was on his way to being the father of a great nation. He was on the journey, which means that you are running to something. Now he's a refugee, which means that he's running from something. It's really easy to Monday morning quarterback Abraham's decisions. But if you're in his sandals, there are some tough calls to make. And even though we're talking about an ancient story here, there are some things that have a real familiar feel to this, if you think about it. Have you ever been disappointed with where you ended up? In a relationship? A job? Career? Family? Like you thought, I'm going to have a fairy tale marriage, but it's not. Or you thought, by this time I'll be married, but I'm not. Or maybe you thought, I'll have a big family. And then you thought, okay, maybe I'll have a child. And you're still waiting. I thought this was just going to be our starter home, not the 2 decades and we're still here home. Or I thought I would get to live in this house until I died. And now they tell me I can't live here alone. I thought these would be the years that we would travel and do the things that we couldn't afford to do when we were young. And now we can afford to do the things that we want to do, but we don't have the health to do it. I thought I would retire at this job, but this job is retiring me. A lot of us are like Abraham. We thought we were headed to a promised land. And then when we got there, it was famine land. And we've had to face a really hard truth. And it's a truth that the prosperity preachers who focus on the end of this story instead of the middle don't want you to really know. Because if you know this part of the story, you'll stop sending them money. But this part of the story is true. Sometimes God's promises take us through barren places. Sometimes God's promises lead us into seasons of famine and need and poverty. Sometimes we are brought to places not so that we will be blessed, but so that we will be a blessing. The faith with which Abraham embraced God's promise has evaporated like mid-morning mist on the river. He believed the journey would take him to a place of security and significance. Instead, he winds up in a place of scarcity and danger. He takes a detour because the journey takes him to places he didn't expect to go. And sometimes it's going to take us to places we don't expect to go to. Don't you ever let me or anybody else leave you with the impression that if you just walk faithfully with God every step of the way along the journey, that your life is going to be sunshine and daisies. Because that's not true. Sometimes you can walk very faithfully with God on every step of the journey, and it's going to take you to places you don't want to be. That may not be good news, but it's true. The question is, how are we going to respond when that happens? So Abraham goes to Egypt. That's how he responds. And on the way, he says to Sarai, I need you to lie for me. You tell him you're my sister. And it's clever, and it works. They think she's his sister. And they give him all kind of gifts in order to keep brother happy. They give him sheep and cattle and camels and servants. But just because a plan works doesn't make it a good plan. This plan was bad from the beginning because where it came from, you remember the Moltmann quote? Anxiety anticipates danger. Hope anticipates deliverance. Abraham is making all of his decisions, all of his plans out of anxiety. He anticipates danger from the famine, so he detours to Egypt. Then he anticipates danger from the Egyptians, so he detours from honesty and decides to lie. He's not deciding and planning and acting out of faith and hope that God will deliver. His plans now are coming out of anxiety and the fear of danger. And plans and decisions and actions that come from that kind of anxiety typically turn out bad for everybody. Well, it really doesn't look like it turned out bad for Abraham, though, does it? I mean, he got all kind of rewards from the Egyptians, right? They made him rich. He got livestock. And the Bible even says they gave him so much stuff, they had to give him people to help manage it. They gave him maidservants and men servants. Four chapters later, in fact, we meet one of those female servants, an Egyptian handmaid named Hagar. Now, we don't have time to get into that story right now, but trust me, it does not turn out well for Abraham or Sarah or Hagar or her son. And the truth is, centuries later, we're still sort of dealing with some decisions Abraham made in his anxiety. We'll read Genesis chapter 16 about Hagar. Abraham acquired her in Egypt, and it becomes an issue later on. Here's the problem with decisions made out of anxiety. They eventually catch up with you. It's kind of like when you fall. Yesterday, I fell. I took the dogs for a walk. I crossed a spillway. You know why they call them spillways? Halfway across the spillway, I spilled. I'm going to talk to this side for a little while. Sheep, goats. You know, yesterday when I fell, it was not a big deal. I got up. I was a little embarrassed because there was a guy fishing about 50 feet away, a young guy, and he said, "Are you okay?" And I went, "Yeah, I'm good." You know? Little algae down there, you know? Stupid dog. Yeah. This morning, I rolled over and I said to Lisa, "I hurt." Stuff that happens to you, sometimes, you know, right now, it's not a big deal. A couple of days later, you feel it. That's the way decisions made in anxiety are. It's like a fall. You don't feel it right then. Later, it'll catch up with you. And that's what happens to Abraham here. He ends up making detours because he doesn't trust God. Abraham's unfaith created a huge mess for Pharaoh, even. God afflicted Pharaoh's house with plagues, which, can I just say, that doesn't seem fair to me. I don't know what to do with it. If that troubles you, you're not alone. Abraham lied, Pharaoh suffers. Abraham was supposed to be a blessing. His lack of faith made him a curse. I guess a takeaway is that we're all more connected to one another than any of us imagine. How you live has an impact on me, and how I live has an impact on you. If you walk in faith, it's going to bless me. If I walk in faith, it will bless you. If we walk in faith, it will bless this community. And if we don't walk in faith, we will not be a blessing to this community. But for me, the most astounding part of the story is the end. Abraham leaves Egypt a rich man. In fact, in the very next chapter, in Genesis chapter 13, it says that he had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and in gold. What do you make of that? Did Abraham deserve to be made rich? No. In fact, may I remind you of his nefarious ways? He manipulated his wife with a compliment. He was willing to sacrifice her to save himself. He asked her to lie for him. He lied himself, and he profited from his deception. Does that sound like a worthy person to you? No. That sounds like somebody who needs a presidential pardon. But there's a little breadcrumb here, a little foreshadowing, pointing to something bigger, bigger than this story, bigger than Abraham, something that has to do with God and how God acts. Here is someone who has done nothing to deserve deliverance, but is delivered nonetheless. Here is someone who has not earned the riches he receives, but is abundantly enriched. Here is someone who has acted out of faithless anxiety, and yet God remains awesomely faithful. God blesses a man who does not deserve it. God delivers a man who is willing to sacrifice others. God is faithful to a man who was unfaithful. And that last paragraph was not about Abraham at all. It was about me. And it was about you. It's about us. Because that's what God did for you and me through Jesus on a cross. Paul puts it this way in Romans chapter 5. You see, at just the right time, when we were powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And since we've been justified by his blood, how much more will we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? That's the truth, and that is good news. We're going to sing a song to get us ready for our time of communion. The words are going to be really familiar to you. The tune is a little bit different, so hopefully it's going to make us listen a little better. Let's sing.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Lord, to his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?
Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were
Let's pray together. Father, we are Abraham, and we are Sarah, and we are Hagar, and we are Rahab, and we are Peter and Saul. We are all of these people that we read about in your ancient word. Now faithful, now anxious, striving to stay on the path and then taking detours. None of us have walked a straight path. None of us have stayed on our feet the whole way. All of us have taken the spill. And yet, through the ages, you remain faithful. You are God. And through what you did on the cross in Jesus, you make it okay for us to get back on the path and walk with you again. Thank you for the cross of Jesus. Thank you for his willingness to die there for us, to give up his body so that we may have the blessing of fellowship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
O cleanser of the mess I've made, upon a hill our places trade. Stretched on a cross, your body crushed, by human hands you formed from dust. How
Father, thank you for the cup that we're about to share, the symbol of the blood that Jesus spilled for us. Thank you for the love it took to carry him up that hill and to stay on that cross. And we're sorry. We are deeply sorry that that is what it took. But we are deeply grateful that he was willing to take it. In Jesus' name, amen.
O cleanser of the mess I made, your boundless love for me portray. With patience for my learning curve, by holding back what I deserve. How you for all you. stand as we close? I just hope that you will keep a memory of Jody falling in your mind all week this week. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
You are the everlasting God.
Thank you so much for bringing Jody and Lisa to our church family. We pray that you'll continue to bless them. Father, we have a large number of people in this family that are grieving because of the loss of loved ones. We pray that you will provide comfort for them as only you can. Father, we want to pray a special prayer for Megan White, as many of us do every day, and we pray that you will restore her to her health. We pray that everything that we do this week will be as a worship to you. Help us not to just worship today, but worship every day that we live because of your magnificent being. We thank you for Jesus and all that you allowed him to go through so that we could be reconnected with you. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.